our course, and today I want to conclude with illustrating some method that is called Cartan method or non-holonomic frame, as I mentioned about it in previous lectures. So, and some words about multidimensional case, because as we saw last time, that in four-dimensional time-space everything is classified, so you always can think that everything probably is done. So the theory is complete, so what is left is to study some technical parameters of Einstein solutions and something else. So probably you've heard about this string theory, yes? And this is the idea that that our space is not four-dimensional, yes, but you have some additional dimensions which exist only on very small scale, yeah. So, and everything, all these quantum effects can be interpreted in different language, in geometrical language. So, as far as I know, in the very first theory, that additional, so we have four-dimensional time space R1 3, and in every point of this space you have some additional space, yes, and this space was introduced to explain some quantum effects. And so firstly it was just one-dimensional circle, yeah, and this circle was some deforming somehow, and because of the varying this form, physicists want to give some new explanation of the quantum effects, so it can be deformed some, and these different forms of this strange string should explain many quantum characteristics like mass, charge, and so on and so on. Then the next idea was to attach something more complicated at every point. So now there is M theory. So now somebody wants to attach a brain, yeah, membrane. So it can be two-dimensional, it can be seven-dimensional or eight-dimensional, and so on. For example, I will explain it later. So one type of theories claims that this manifold should be odd-dimensional and be Calabi-Yau manifold. Did you hear about this Calabi-Yau manifolds? What?
I didn't.
Okay, I'll explain this later. So because in four-dimensional time space basically everything is done, so one should build some new difficult theory just to do something, yeah. And I will explain what is some examples of this. Okay, but firstly I will illustrate Cartan method. Uh, So let's us remember what is a three-dimensional sphere. Three-dimensional sphere is the set of those vectors from four-dimensional space, which is equal to two-dimensional complex space, such that its length equals to one. Well, it is easy. What is U2? U2 is those matrices such that, so A star is A conjugated. So this is 2x2 matrices with complex components. Star is a transposition and conjugating in complex numbers. And this should be equal to identity 2x2 matrices. So this is U2. If you also will put this additional condition that the determinant of this matrix will be equal to 1, then you get SO2. So some stupid example, yeah? So for example, we want to calculate, we consider this matrix to be U2. So we should write down this equation. Okay. I write down the identity matrix as a Kronecker symbol. This is the same. Okay, so what do we have? We have four equations, yeah? So AA bar plus CC bar equals to 1. A bar B plus C bar D equals to 0. B bar A plus D bar C equals to 0, and plus BB bar plus DD bar equals to 1. So how many dimensions do we have here? So if any of these numbers were complex, we have four complex numbers, it means that we have eight number of eight degrees of freedom here, yeah, and we have four equations here. So this is four, and it is can be. Because you see, any of these equations is real, actually. It's not complex. So any matrix from U2 can be written down as minus B bar A bar, but with multiplication by angle, for example, with a phi, and here you should multiply by a complex number of unitary length. Okay. So when you will write down one of those equations, you will see that A module squared plus B module squared equals to 1 here, yeah? But determinant of this matrix is equal to what? To e in the power of I phi. Yes? Yes. So if you will demand that this determinant will equal to 1, you will exactly get the three-dimensional sphere in four-dimensional space. Okay, so this is a proof that this sphere, three-dimensional sphere, is a Lie group. Lie group is just might see of Lie group as some matrix group. So it means that it both a manifold and a group. So there is some smooth structures. You can consider tangent planes and everything else, but also there is a multiplication structure here. So this is rare example. For example, you know that S1 is a Lie group. Yes, this is just a circle because you can rotate this. Three-dimensional sphere is also a Lie group, but already seven-dimensional sphere, which lies in octanionic. This is in C. S3 is in quaternionic space. But this is already not a Lie group because there is no associativity here. Okay, so this method, I just mention all these simple calculations to emphasize that this method works really good only when you have some additional structure, like structure on Lie groups, or for example on the homogeneous space. Homogeneous space is when you have some Lie group and you factorize it by some Lie subgroup. For example, if you will factorize a three-dimensional sphere by one-dimensional circle, you will get two-dimensional sphere. This is well-known Hopf vibration. Hopf vibration. So, more usual notation for this is the following. When you have base phi, this is all called locally trivial bundle. Yes. So this is some generalization of the Descartes product. So you have two-dimensional sphere, and it at each point of two-dimensional sphere you have one-dimensional circle, yes, and you put this on one point, and you begin to move this point around this base, around this two-dimensional sphere, and the circle began to rotate. Yes, so and you should do this. You should glue all these fibers, one-dimensional fibers, such that all the picture will be the three-dimensional sphere. Well, it can be done. I don't want to, because all this. Techniques, they are basically topological techniques, and this is not our theme, but in mathematics it is usually considered to be the most interesting and important constructions. Okay, so three-dimensional sphere, and we have coordinates on this sphere, which are angles, and we can write them down. Okay. Exponent in the power of I half psi plus phi. Okay. And z plus it equals to r sine theta half e to the power of e psi minus phi. So you see that x, y, z, and t, they are coordinates in R4, and this is coordinate in 1C, and this is coordinate in the second C, and R is just, it is easy to understand, the R squared is equals to x plus y plus z plus t squared. And yes, so R is, as always, a radial coordinate, and we have three angles, theta, psi, and phi. Actually, to be more precise, one should write down the limits where this angle are defined. They are the following. Okay. And we want to define some one forms that lives on three-dimensional sphere. Okay, thanks. The first one is the following. So from this notation you can see that this is only the case for the three-dimensional sphere. That is very how to say? Oops, I think this is some typo. Dx, I think, plus y dz minus z dy. So this case, three-dimensional sphere, is very. I forgot this word. Exceptional. And this technique works only in this case, that you can write down such very symmetric and nice dz. Dz plus x dy minus y dx. So you see that that if you will put r equals to 1, although this you see you have here three differential one form, but if you will put R to 1, this differential form will be defined on this three-dimensional sphere that lies on in four-dimensional space. Okay, so actually we can write down that E1, for example, equals to this formulas, and you can write down it's implicitly. Using these formulas. Okay. So, and after this, we will forget about angles. These angles, actually, they are Euler angles on the three-dimensional sphere. After we put these formulas, we will forget about the angles completely. So, what we're interested in is in this basis of one forms. So this is all basis in one forms of on three-dimensional sphere. It is easy to check that they are linearly independent. It means that they form some new frame in this space. So the standard basis here is d theta, d phi, and d psi, but we find some new basis of forms, and this is a very good basis. And it is very nice to use it. Why? Because if you will write down this equation, what will you have? Any guess?
Plus or minus E3.
No, it cannot be, because this is two form.
Okay.
So what can you do with forms? You can have wedge product, what else? Come on. What else can you do with the differential forms? You have two form, yeah? This is two form. And of course, to be very symmetric and very beautiful formula, from the right hand side you have something depends on E3, yes? So the formulas will be very symmetric when you change, when you rotate the indices, yeah? So what can you do with one form E3 to get two form? What operation can make one form to two form? What?
Taking the derivative.
No, derivative. It calls differential. in when you deal with forms. You see, this basis is very privileged, and this is, of course, is true. Maybe here you should put two somewhere or one half. I don't remember exactly, but it doesn't. Of course, it doesn't. Very important. It is not very important. So maybe one half d e. 2, 3, 1 and 3, 1, 2. Actually, probably I can check. No. Ah, yes, it's correct. Okay. So you see that this is basis is much better than that one because it respects wedge product on differential one form and the structure of the algebra of one form. So on the algebra of one forms, you have wedge product and you have differential, and this is very this basis is very good for these two structures. For example, if you will consider d of d theta, you will always get zero, yes? Okay, so basically this is a non-holonomic. Nomic frame. Sometimes somebody plays here co, because when you speak about frame, usually you speak about some basis in tangent space, yes? And this is one forms, they forms a frame in cotangent space or the space of one forms. They are basically the same. Okay. So, why non-holonomic? Non-holonomic is just the following thing. So, one forms, they what they doing with vector fields. If you have one form, how can I explain this? Do you know what is adjoint vector space? Adjoint vector space, yes. So you have a vector space and you have a vector space of linear functionals on this vector space, yes. So there is a duality between these spaces. So this is linear functionals, one forms, they are linear functionals on the vector fields, yes? So if when you have a vector field, you can put this vector field to the differential one form and you get a scalar function, yes? Okay, so this is basis in adjoint vector space, and the true vector space is a tangent space. So you can consider the dual basis. Basis in TS3. These are the vector fields, and basically these formulas on the differential one forms in terms of vector fields, they will be the following. So here I I think maybe you should put here too. So if you consider the Lie bracket on the vector fields, it with some formulas will be in correspondence with wedge product on the one forms 2, 3, 1 and 3, 1, 3, 1, 2. Okay, and the non-holonomic is exactly because of this. It means that the vector fields that we have here that are dual to our basis there, they are not holonomic. It means that if you calculate the Lie brackets, it's not zero. It means that you cannot construct, if you consider, for example, should put it below. If you construct the surface that have Xi1 and Xi2 as its tangent vector space, it will be impossible. Yeah, I've explained it in previous lectures. So it's this basis is non-holonomic. Well, and actually this is a very, very usual thing in differential geometry. It is much comfortable and easy to use this type of basis. Not coordinate basis, but this non-holonomic basis, because from some point of view, the curvature of the space, you understand that three-dimensional sphere is not a flat space. Yes, it is round, it is curved, and in some, although you cannot imagine it, you understand that it is not flat space, yes? And when you choose this type of frame, you put its curvature inside of this, of the structure of the frame. And yes, and sometimes this frame calls moving frame, because it is changed from, it is rotate when you change the tangent point on your manifold. So okay. Let us consider this type of metric, A1 squared, E1 squared. So dt is just dt. E1, as you can see, it is some combination of d phi, d psi, and d theta. But we will forget about this. Now we will work only with this type of notations. A2 plus A3, where functions A1 and A2 and A3 is a function only on coordinate T. So this is some metric, and we want to understand, for example, when will it be Ricci flat, and give the solution of Einstein equations. To understand this, we should calculate Cartan structural equations, and this is not very difficult, but still okay. So in this So basically, what do we want? We want some equations on these functions. Yes, this will be when we will calculate the, for example, the Riemann tensor and or the Ricci tensor. We will put it to the zero. Yes, if we wanted to find some Ricci flat matrix, and we will get some equations to on these functions. Depends only on one variable. Okay. What?
That Riemann tensor and Ricci tensor is equal to zero when it is a flat space.
Not flat space, but for example, Ricci tensor is equal to zero for Schwarzschild metric. Schwarzschild metric is metric of not flat space, yes, but still the Ricci tensor is zero for it.
Yeah, maybe, but covariant derivatives are not zeros, no? For the current space.
Not zeros. Yes.
But here also we are considering the curved space or flat space.
Once again.
Here we are considering curved space or flat space.
Cone. Yes, this is a cone. So, for example, yeah, it's good, question. So, for example, if we will consider AI, all of them equals to T squared, yes? So what we will have then? Then this metric will be just DT squared plus T squared, and here we'll have E1 squared plus E2 squared plus E3 squared. Yes, this is exactly the metric on the DS on the three-dimensional sphere. Yes, so this is the metric on three-dimensional sphere, and we consider its deformation from some point of view. If all these functions will be equal to t, and we will have here t squared, this will be exactly the cone metric over S3, and this is exactly the flat metric of R4. Yes, so this is just basically the same as the standard spherical system of coordinate, when T plays the role of radial coordinate. But for example, we can consider different functions here, and we want to find not only this is flat, this is metric is flat, it is absolutely flat. The whole Riemannian tensor equals zero here, not only Ricci, but the whole tensor is zero. So this is the metric of the flat space. Okay. So what should we calculate to get our equations?
Since that to consider the Schwarzschild radius, this Ricci tensor is zero because the Schwarzschild radius is not very much, or
no? I just want to calculate some Riemann tensor or Ricci tensor. I don't want to talk about whether it equals zero or not. Just to demonstrate how does this technique works. So we will calculate Ricci tensor and then we will speak. Okay, so to calculate all we want, we should uh, form a new basis. In this basis, this metric looks like dt squared plus e1 squared plus e2 squared plus e3 squared. And you might think that it is flat. No, it is not, because the frame that sits here is not consists on the full derivative of some coordinate. This frame of differential one forms is not holonomic. So this metric is not flat. So this was from lecture, I think, number 13, when I said that this is a non-holonomic frame where the metric is constant. Yes, so you see that there is no some functions here. Yes, the metric looks like constant, but it is actually wrong, because here in the frame there is sits some curvature in here, because frame is not holonomic. Okay. In Minkowski space, no. I mean, Minkowski space.
May I answer? It's almost looks like constant, but it's.
Well, yes, in Minkowski space, yes, but in Minkowski space, you have dt squared minus dx squared minus dy squared minus dz squared. So this is absolutely constant. Because these forms, yes, for example, if it would be E1, this is a full differential of some coordinate, yeah? Here, E1 is not a full differential of some coordinate. And it means that this basis is not holonomic, and it depends on some functions, and vary in this function you can consider different metrics with different curvatures. And here you cannot vary anything here in standard Minkowski. We form new basis. E0 equals to dt E1, E2, E3. This is new basis, and we want to find connection form. What is this? This is just the generalization of Christoffel symbols, but for non-holonomic basis. This thing omega ij equals to minus omega ji is called connection one form. So what it is? So you have two indices, yes, here, I and j. And for when you fix indices I and j, this will be some differential one form. So at each differential I'll just put it down, not to talk too much. For example, for this matrix, so it is some linear problem to calculate the components of this connection form. Just like, for example, you need to do some calculations to calculate Christoffel symbols. And it is Q-symmetric, as you see. This is some I just want to emphasize one more, that we consider Riemannian case, not Lorentzian. For Lorentzian, almost everything is the same. So we have signature of our metric is plus, plus, plus. And for this basis this connection one form can be calculated, and it equals to the following. So it is Q-symmetric, so here we have minus that, and here we have components here that looks like that. Minus a1 plus a2 minus a3 divided by 1, 2, 3, and here e2. And the last component is here. So what is important? Important is the following, that for any component of this matrix, so here we have minus this triangle, yeah, because of that. What is important? That this connection one form have actually three indices, because every component of this matrix is a one form, yes? One form is a combination of some basic one forms, E0 and E3, yes? So basically here we have for this connection one form, we have three indices, yes? And this is just the same as for the Christoffel symbols. Yes.
There is
this is some kind of you see what was the definition of Christoffel symbols in more abstract way. If you have some E I and you covariantly differentiate E I along E j, you will get what? You will get E I j k E k. Yes? So basically this is almost the same. Look, it's from long distance. Yes? At these formulas. So here if you will construct if you will consider the covariant derivative of EI along all EJ, so you will erase J index here and put it here, and you will get just this. So this is covariant derivative, this is differential. This is covariant derivative of one vector field with respect to another vector field. This is differential of one forms. But this is the result of this operation is some vector field also. And the result of this operation is some two form. Yes? And so this is just almost the same things, but written down in different terms. So this is in terms of vector fields, and this is in terms of one differential one forms. And by the way, you see this, there is this skew symmetry, yes, or for the connection one form. And for Christoffel symbols, you have that type of symmetry, yes? So this is just almost the same, but in different terms. So you should look at this this connection one form as on the generalization of covariant derivatives on the basic vector fields. Okay, so should we make a break? Yes. Okay, let's make a small break. To illustrate where from these formulas are. So you should find such coefficients here that satisfies that equation and that. So what do you do? You do the following. So you consider dE0. dE0 is d dt. It is 0. Yes? dE1, what is that? This is d of a1 e1. Then you use Leibniz rule. So this is d a1 prime dt e1 plus a1 dE1. But d1 was equal to what? To 2 e2 which e3 or 1/2, I don't remember. 2. Okay, so and this all this formula should be in terms of this is e0, e1 and e3. So you should divide by e1. Dt is e0, and when you divide, you also multiply by a1, and this will be e1, this e1 instead of that. And here you will have what? 2 a1 a2 a3 e2 wedge e3 and so on. And then you should calculate such coefficients here that is skew-symmetric with respect to these indexes and satisfying that formulas. So you see here, yes? So this was dE1 and it should be equal to minus omega 1 k wedge e k. So for example, omega 1 0 should be equal something like that, yes? And this is here since. And with this, it is a little bit more complicated, but using some combinations, you will find out that this is correct formulas. For example, we should multiply this e3 by e2. This e2 you multiply by e3. Then you sum these two forms, and you should find the dE2. Okay, never mind. This is the details. So finding the solution of some not very difficult linear system of equations, you find these components. What next? Next, this was the connection form, yes? So basically, what one should do to find the curvature? This is also You should also look at this formula from far away. So what do we have here? This is some derivatives of Christoffel symbols. Yes, derivatives. And this some combination of squares of Christoffel symbols. If you remember this theorem from the very first lectures, to calculate the curvature through the Christoffel symbols, the formula was looking just the same. You have some differentials of Christoffel symbols plus some combination of squares of Christoffel symbols. And notice here that because this covariant, because this connection one form is Q-symmetric here and wedge product, all these minuses, they sit here correctly. So this is some kind of magic, that this notation became very, very short instead of this theorem, this Gauss-Egregium theorem with great formula just to calculate the curvature of the surface. So this is main advance of this method because everything became very, very short. Short to write down formulas. And this is more or less explicitly. And what is the connection with standard Riemannian tensor is the following. So omega capital equals to 1/2 R I J K L to calculate the components of the Riemannian tensor, you should calculate this differential to form. Of course, it calls curvature to form. And this is just components of Riemannian tensor in basis, in frame, components in the frame E0, E1, E2, E3. So you should fix some basis, yes, to calculate the components, and this basis is this one. Okay, and then begin some calculations. So this method is very useful. So just let me write down the example of the calculations. Yes, because omega 0, 0 and omega 1, 1 is they are zeros. Yes, actually here you should have four summons, and when you calculate all this stuff, you will get the following. Well, it is not very easy, but it is just some technical problems to calculate all this stuff. And finally, of course, you can calculate Ricci tensor. Yes, and this Ricci tensor will be some. I don't have it here, probably. So, okay. And then you can use these formulas just to calculate and to investigate your matrix. This is more easy because some curvature already sits in this basis. Already sits here, and it is some inner property of this frame, and it makes your calculation a little bit shorter. But you should always keep in mind that this is not flat frame; it is moving frame. Okay, so you calculate this, you calculate that. For example, if you consider the case with symmetry, when A2 equals to A3, then Ricci will be like that. And the last component . So still you see that even in this setting, when you have only two unknown functions A1 and A2, the formulas for the curvature is not simple. Still, you can prove some results. Plus 8 divided by A2 squared. For example, what solutions for the Einstein equations can you find in this setting?
Einstein equations. we have only 10 in that, right? In that Einstein equation, we have only 10
condoms.
Yeah.
Yes.
And 6 are duplicates.
Mm-hmm.
And what about here?
So I wrote down this formula for 0, 1, yes? And you saw that was something here of this type plus something of that, yes? So it means that if this coefficient between 2, 3 is not 0, it means that R 0, 1, 2, 3 is not 0. Yes, so basically all components here, yes, are not vanished.
16.
Well, I don't remember, yes, probably. So.
But here we are dealing with only space, but in case of Einstein equation, their energy, stress and energy momentum.
No. This is just some last lecture about some studies in Riemannian geometry. Yes. So because you see that there was great work done in four-dimensional space. Yes. So I think that if there was no general relativity, yes, with this big challenge to calculate all the exact solutions that describes our universe, these methods, I suppose, never would appear. Because these methods, this is really strong methods, but it is very useful to use it for describe general relativity, yes, formulas and techniques. But it also works in high dimensional space.
No, this, if you replace the Ricci tensor with this one.
Energy tensor.
Ricci tensor.
Ricci tensor.
Einstein equation.
Yes, I just do this. For example, this is not very humble, but I can write down some my theorem about this metric. Okay. So, for example, so we consider this metric with two unknown functions, yes? A1 and A2, they are... What?
Last term.
Last term is 8 divided by A2 squared. So we have two unknown functions, A1 and A2. And we ask the question, when does this metric have some good properties? Yes, for example, if the Ricci tensor is equals to 0, yes, what should we do? We should write down this equals to 0, this equals to 0, and that equals to 0, and to solve. Can you solve this type of equations? No. Because, well, it's too difficult. This is the main reason. So you have three equations, yes, of the second order, three equations on two functions. So basically it's overdefined, yes. So you actually don't know what to do then. Well, numerical is not very mathematical. You want to find some exact solutions. So just if you will put, I found that if you will consider this type of conditions on these functions, plus k3 prime l1 l2 plus l3. Suppose that in addition these two functions satisfy this system of equations. Yes, suppose that this is true for some fixed numbers k1, k2, k3 and l1, l2, l3. Then you can prove that there is some different solution for the Einstein equation. For example, if Ricci equals zero, Ricci equals zero, it means that lambda term is zero, yeah, in Einstein equations. It means that you have three cases. First one is Taub-Knut metric. Second metric is Eguchi-Hansen. This is old well-known metrics which was of some importance in physics. Even I think this metric is very important in geometry because there is some object that called K3 surface, and this metric is needed to construct the differential structure of this object. The third metric is some metric that I found, but I cannot prove yet that this is a metric actually new. So yes, and we suppose that A1 is not equal to A2, because among all these solutions also there is, for example, flat solution. Simple flat when A1 equals A2 equals to T. Yes, this is also the solution, but we exclude these very standard solutions from our consideration. And if lambda is not zero, so we have Einstein but not Ricci flat solution, it means that the only case here is Fubini-Studi metric. Okay. So basically, this method. Why did I mention this string theory? Because in nowadays it is very popular. Actually, nowadays it is not very popular because there is some, I don't know, not very optimistic point of view on string theory and all this M theory. Yes, it is not very popular now.
There are no ways to check.
Yes, mostly because of that. Because the scales where these effects should appear, they are too small. We cannot, yes, sub-quantum level, and probably this will be theory forever. But still, there is such thing as holonomy group. What is that? You have manifold, you have a loop on this manifold, and you consider the parallel transport along this loop of some tangent vector. Yes, it was vector v, and you get vector phi of v. And you consider, and this phi depends on loop gamma. Yeah. Then you consider all these transitions. Because this was a parallel transport, the lengths of v and the lengths of phi of v will be the same, yes, because this was parallel transport. So this is some subgroup in On, where n is the dimension of your manifold. So this is exactly the holonomy group.
Could you please repeat what is phi sub gamma?
So this is the result of parallel transport along loop gamma. So you have one vector in this tangent space and another vector in the same tangent space with the tangent point the same. Their length equals, yes, and what? Yes, direction is different. Yes, and if you fix the loop, yes, and you consider, for example, you will increase the length of your vector, then the length of this vector will increase accordingly, the same, yes? So actually this phi of gamma, this is some linear matrix. So it just rotates your vector from this to that, and it depends on gamma. Then you consider all gamma, all loops, and you will get some set of orthogonal matrices. Orthogonal because they don't change angles and lengths. This group called holonomy group, and there is a classification of all possible holonomy groups. It calls Berger lists. First, it is the general holonomy group is the whole group. But there is some more interesting cases. U n by 2. This is Keller manifold. S u n by 2. This is Calabi Yau manifold, and this manifold is Ricci flat. Next one, SPn divided by 4. So this is Hyperkeller. Yes, yes. Hyperkeller manifold. And this is, they are also Ricci flat. SPn divided by 4. So when I write n divided by 4, I mean that n equals to 4m for some different m. SP1. This is quaternionic Keller manifold. And they are Einstein. So if you find some manifold with holonomy equals to that, It is automatically Einstein manifold. Yes, it is automatically satisfy Einstein equations. The same for the Calabi-Yau and Ricci flat. Two exceptional groups, this in dimensional 7 and that in dimensional 8. These two holonomy groups calls exceptional. There is some Cartan classification of all Lie groups, and if you are interested, you can find what is G2. But they are also Ricci flat automatically. So, and for a long time, there was a basic idea that this additional manifold that we have attached to our space-time, so we have R13, our space-time, and this additional manifold that should explain all these quantum effects should be either Calabi-Yau manifold or some of that ones. Because this manifold with matrix that have these special holonomies, it is very good. So you have there some additional spinners and so on. So their characteristics from geometrical point of view can be interpreted from some kind of quantum mechanics. I don't really know all this stuff.
This same concept can be applicable for 1D universe also.
Maybe, I don't know. So this is basically words, because I'm not specialist in applying these concrete manifolds to the quantum effects. But you see, for a mathematician, when you have this problem, just to construct some, and this manifold, it considered to be Riemann, yes? So we have only one-dimensional time. This manifold should be compact because we don't see these additional dimensions, yes? This manifold that describe quantum effects, it should be very small and compact, of course. So this manifold should be Riemannian manifold. Yes. So, and if a mathematician have this problem, which is formulated in these terms, it is a nice task to find examples of some of this matrix. For example, I found some family of this matrix in high dimensions. And that one, but no, this. So there is different other techniques. So if you want to, from some physical point of view, if you think that the dimension of this manifold is 7, then it is reasonable to find this manifold with holonomy G2 and so on. Okay. So there are different ways to solve Einstein equations. For example, you can find some special matrix with special holonomy group. It means that if your metric is, if your holonomy is small enough, then you will find automatically solution for the Einstein equations. And there is still some activity in mathematics to find this matrix, especially in high-dimensional space. Also, when you find the metric, you should investigate, is there some singularities, yes, for example, or it is anywhere smooth, and this type of questions. Calculate some forms, some cohomologies and topology of the space where this metric is defined. Well, and so on, so on. So there is very big activity here, but still it is became less popular for, I think, about last 20 years it is not very popular to find all this stuff. Okay, so I think it is enough for our course. Okay, thanks. What?
Do you have any questions?
Yes, questions, of course. And for those who want to make an exam, next week, I hope I will send all these words, yes, for the lectures. And I think that the question on exam will consist on these words. There is a site, do you know? No. I sent to everybody this where these videos are put. So there is some small words about what each lecture was. Yes, for example, Schwarzschild metric or I don't know, Euler-Lagrange equations. So this is the main definition, the main theorems. So probably we will talk by email, yes, and then fix some concrete time and place, and then we will make some exam. Just to have a good mark, you probably should know just basic definitions, and to remember this Schwarzschild metric is a must. You must remember Schwarzschild metric.
Okay.
Yes.
Question: How will be the questions? Is there any? How you are going to ask the questions?
In written form.
Okay. How many questions do you have to?
I don't know. Five.
Five questions?
Yes, but the question will be small. You should know just some definition, and maybe only one or two questions will contain some calculations, some long calculations. You'll see. Don't be afraid. Just look.
Is that important to take this exam?
Well, I think it is. Well, actually, I don't want to do it myself too.
One more question about it. Will we able to use our notes?
Your notes. It is. It is a hard question. Well, because I don't know. Because if probably no. Because if there is no there are no small tasks, there is no small exercises in this course. Yes, so I could ask you to calculate something, but it is always not easy. Yes, to do all the calculations and in this general relativity. So I don't know if I can only ask questions on the course. It means that everything that I could ask, you can just look in your papers, yes, in your notes.
Okay.
I mean that either I should ask some really difficult exercises, either I should ask some easy definitions. I prefer.
Sir, please send some example type of questions. Like.
Yes, I will send. I will send for those who want to make an exam. Then I probably talk with Dolgov. Okay. So don't be worried. Just do you have time? Yes. Are you going to go home or where, what?
Next week would be. When you are going to take the exam?